Hello, everybody, and welcome. It is Alex here from the Shadow Path headquarters. And this is our first Formidable Friday, the making of a festival. And we have gathered some brainstormers to pick their brain on how a new kind of classical play festival can best serve their creative needs. So a little bit of background, Shadow Path received some funding to research and explore the possibility of presenting a classical play festival featuring female writers. That will happen next spring, 2021, on both virtual platforms and hopefully in person as well. Because our aim is to nurture and highlight female creativity, we wanted to tap into the direct source, and hence we have the brainstormers here. Before we jump into question number one, I will just quickly pass it over to our associate producer and fellow brainstormer, Maisa.
Hello, everyone. We have all come together to discuss, to celebrate, and acknowledge the work and lives of female playwrights through the ages. Many of these women and their works have been forgotten or ignored as time marched forward over their stories. Before we move on to them, we would like to acknowledge the earliest storytellers that lived on the lands we now occupy. These are the traditional lands and territories of the Mississaugas, the New Credit First Nation, the Wendat, the Anishinaabes, and the Haudenosaunee peoples. Regardless of who occupies the land now, the histories of those who previously cared for it, the stories they told, and the lives they lived are still an integral part of it. Ensuring the lives and stories of other forgotten people, we've helped to create a bridge between all people and work toward a more inclusive future where each of us is heard and all our contributions are acknowledged and remembered.
Thank you, Maisa. Great. So we have actually quite an eclectic array of artists here with us from all different backgrounds and expertise, from performers to playwrights to producers to artistic directors and educators and choreographers and theater makers. And without further ado, brainstormers, are you ready? Okay, so we're gonna jump right in to question number one. Brainstormers. Beyond presenting classical plays by women, how can we at Shadow Path best engage and support female theater artists?
I can answer some of that. I mean, I think that obviously, not just, although it is really important because the numbers are very low in terms of the numbers of female or female identified playwrights, the numbers remain low across our whole country, actually, in terms of how many plays by female playwrights are produced, but also in the various roles. We know that the numbers of female directors are low by comparison, exceptionally so. And in any power positions across the board, artistic directorships, et cetera, these posts are very rarely held by women. And despite the change in numbers we've seen in Toronto, still remain very low across the country. But even within that, I think we need to acknowledge it's not just about, though it is obviously about women and people who identify as female, but it's also looking at the most marginalized within that group. So that we can look to expand opportunities in every possible role in the theater to female and female identified artists, but specifically also targeting marginalized groups within that group, I think. And particularly developing positions of power or offering training and development so that they can enter into positions of power, so that they can become the decision makers in the creative process. That's what I'll say to start us off.
I'll just chime in regarding the festival's anti-harassment policies. I think in terms of creating a space for female identifying folk that feels safe. I'm curious about what, I guess, kind of a contract could be created that very clearly outlines what behaviors are and aren't acceptable within the festival and anything involved with the festival, specifically in the creation process or the rehearsal process, and outlining if something does go wrong, is there an anti-harassment officer and who is that person that one can turn to? Just making sure that that's very clearly outlined and, you know, equity, if some of the projects in the festival are under equity, they have their very own specific ways of dealing with that, that I have personally recently, I guess, investigated, and there's actually a lot of flaws in it. So I think making sure that you're, I guess, aware of the flaws and we're working with the limits of equity, anti-harassment boundaries and within those contracts, and then creating your own contract for the non-equity shows. Yeah.
Continue, Rebecca, since you brought up equity, I've been thinking a lot about barriers and why certain people can or cannot, or accessibility, I guess, is the better way to say that. And equity rehearsal schedule is problematic for some. The really, really long days consecutively, I mean, artistically, personally, I find that it's difficult. I don't know that it gives enough room for imagination and coding and dreaming. I understand often it comes down to budget as well, but I'm a mom, and trying to find daycare, often the job doesn't always cover the daycare. That is a barrier for when I'm trying to do work. So looking at being flexible with rehearsal schedule, or if there's any way to provide some kind of care, or if we can, in a festival situation, if I don't know if there's a way of being creative with someone taking care of another person's child and vice versa, or looking at creative solutions around those difficulties, what might be helpful.
Yeah, I have some thoughts based on like the actual kind of process that would kind of take place within the rehearsal room. I think there's like a couple small things that, like, in my experience as an actor and as like a theater creator, that they go a long way to make the room feel like inclusive and safe for everybody involved. I think we kind of have even observed this today on Zoom is a little trickier, but like often I find female identifying artists, like, their instinct isn't to speak up right away unless they're specifically called on. Like, there's something in that culture where we've been trained, like, wait for your turn, and we all want to give everybody a turn. So I've found, like, sometimes working in spaces where whoever's like running the space is kind of actively making sure, like, so-and-so, do you have a thought? Anybody have a thought? Like, making, kind of creating that space for people to speak out and know that, like, they always are comfortable and, like, able to do that, I think goes a long way. And also just in terms of, like, classical works, I think that there's sometimes often like tropes that kind of go hand in hand with classical pieces, whether about, like, you know, stage combat or like intimacy or even like gendered violence that kind of come up in those classical pieces. And I think that like there's some simple things like working through with, like, you know, the power dynamics of the room acknowledged and like no pressure to improv ever. And like small steps about like making sure you kind of tap into the scene and tap out of the scene again, making it clear that, you know, you can have those boundaries and those guidelines around like when people are expected to engage in those kinds of activities in the work. And just kind of examining how you can make the room as like open and welcoming as possible.
Yeah, and I like to piggyback on Paige, but also several former great common, is that I think one thing that continuously come up is like having decision-making and leadership and problem-solving being also within, within women, because for example, like the problem Mandy has brought up, like all the dilemma about being a mom in rehearsal and being in a festival, it's hard to ask, any male identified leadership to solve and fix this problem when they don't really fully understand the capacity of it. So yeah, again, piggyback on Rosanna's comment, it's having, having representative in all possible corners in the community, in the whole process, every step in the process, I think is very important. And also that involving even the marginalized sections within our own community, I think would be very beneficial as well, because it just gives us a fuller and richer voice when it comes to, actually addressing, the problem from a big picture. Also that I personally feel like from observation and also my, like for myself, is that especially when it comes to classical pieces, sometimes female identifying artists from certain marginalized communities don't really feel like it's relevant to them, because we're not sure. Like sometimes I feel like, yes, I might be invited to participate, but not like whether or not my interpretation and my aesthetic is considered or valued. That's always the bigger questions. And I think by showing, like being an example of how classical work can be done in a different way, would be like a very exciting future possibility that I can see within this festivals. And also like having panels and workshops, like discussions, like what's happening today is like, I think would be exciting to be part of a festival, because then you're going really into the decision-making and process part. Because I often found like marginalized communities, including, artists of color or women or, LGBT communities, what happens in the earlier waves of inclusivity and diversity is always that we're invited, but usually very late in the process. And like when once we join, like things are already done and any changes we can do is too small, too late. Even having a discussion of like what classical plays mean individually from people of all experience and all backgrounds, and what are just curating standards, what's considered worthy and relevant from like our collective different experiences and backgrounds. I think those are all very exciting things that can be explored within the festival.
Yeah, I'm gonna piggyback on that because I agree that we need to challenge casting notions, traditional casting notions that are very colonial. And then we're looking at classical plays that we are often British, let's be very clear. And so there's this very specific, limited idea of what Juliet has to be and what so-and-so has to be. And it's like, oh, the larger funny woman and the this, and, and these notions really just need to go away. And I'm not talking about rewriting those scripts. I'm talking about considering them from broader perspectives. And I think that's something that can be challenged across the board. And then to just bring it back to something Paige referenced and Mandy as well about boundaries. Like, we understand that fight direction is a thing to keep people safe. And we've started to understand, or, some corners of the market have started to understand that intimacy, coordination, or direction is a thing. Do you know? But beyond this, the other thing that hasn't been considered yet is what's the equivalent for the psycho-emotional dynamics of this content? And so, and I'm not trying to sell myself here, but this is something I've been teaching for the last 3 years at George Brown. And I've been invited to develop this curricula, into an actual technique. and which I've been doing. And I feel like that's the next corner of the market that's not being addressed, because it does deal with the notion of having a representative there who can account for whether it's in the case of who to report harassment to, or who can actually not just be a reporting body, but it's somebody who can actually step in and navigate that in an artistic process. So you have an artist who is trained to be able to navigate this, as well as has the kind of HR skills to be able to have a follow-up or have a plan in place, right? Like, that person is missing, right? We don't have that person yet. And that's something that I subjectively am working to develop, I'm doing research on, but also have been practically engaging in, because I think we need it. You know, I think that's a corner that still needs to be considered. There you go.
Just to piggyback on all of that, whenever you go into the past and you kind of try and drag something forward, often a lot of, for lack of a better word, crappy things come along with it. As a queer artist, I've certainly experienced this, particularly in comedy or even in Shakespeare, where my kind is always the butt of jokes or made fun of, and there's so much transphobia. So to make sure that the narratives that you're going into the past and bringing forward reflect today, but they don't just reflect today as a past, but they are on the edge of thought. And I would love it if all of a sudden it was okay to rewrite just a little bit here and there, just to honor the society that we live in now, and not only the society that we live in now, but the one that we hope to live in, to make sure that these narratives are giving us something, and that the audience that that hopefully comes out and sees this, a female identifying audience, see themselves reflected in this and not just as an object or someone who is on the outside or the wrong side of the joke, as it were.
Piggybacking on that, we've been reading so many classical plays by women, and that's a topic that's come up. What do we do with these plays that are sometimes offensive, sometimes easily misinterpreted with mores that are like past, and you know, do we rewrite them? Do we present them as they are? How do we deal with that? And I think it's important at the onset of a festival like this, before we go into production, before we start rehearsals, before we do anything, to discuss what are the triggering points, what's stuck in the past, how do we present this play to a modern audience so they can appreciate it with an open heart and not like closed down because there's all these things in there that they just don't want to hear, or they've heard 1,000 times, or for whatever reason they stop paying attention, and we want them open instead of closed. And I think that's well before you actually start working at all.
Yeah, I agree. I think that you also, like, you know, because I think there are also ways of looking at that content and presenting it textually as it is, but directorially challenging it. And now that's tricky. And it's tricky for a lot of people to figure it out, myself included. But I think that that's kind of another branch of possibility, is really taking these preliminary conversations, which I agree are imperative, right, is really dissecting it before you even get into the room. But I think that you can also make really important statements by challenging it through direction instead of through editing. I'm not saying you shouldn't edit. That's also a great idea. Do you know what I mean? It's also another way to do it. But I'm saying there's an alternative there that can also be brought forward.
Mm-hmm. Just to follow up to that, it's great if it comes from direction or some form of leadership before it actually gets brought into the room. Often people who are from marginalized communities will see something in a script, and then it will be on them, kind of everyone in the room will turn to look to them to be like, oh, can we get away with this or can we not get away with this? And it puts so much pressure and othering on those groups of people to constantly have to be like, that's homophobic, I've got to explain to you why it's homophobic. So if that work can also kind of be done or be discussed about how it's going to be harder for these marginalized groups and these othered folk to take those tropes on and discuss them and do the work for that.
I think there were two things that maybe I'm separating them, and maybe Alex, you can clarify a bit for me, because I think as a person who, you know, comes, you know, was born and raised in and on the African continent, classical plays are not something that are part of, you know, of a culture. And when we think classical plays, you know, it's usually just Eurocentric plays, period, you know. And again, of course, I think your idea is broad in terms of classical and not just limited to, you know, Greek plays, from my understanding, correct me if I'm wrong. But I think when we speak of diversity, I think, you know, going back to the content, right? There's tons of plays written by African and Black playwrights that are never being considered. You know, remember we went to theater school. I just so happened to go to theater school with Alex. And yeah, I recall, you know, I have poor memory, but I don't remember once us doing, I don't think we ever did one Black author, did we? I really honestly don't remember. I'm pretty sure there were all white authors, whether it was classical or modern. I think it's only when I had to bring a monologue, that's when I would go and do my own research. Or maybe that's when maybe when a teacher would be like, oh, you should read this because you're Black and this is what you're gonna be cast as a Black person. And I think, you know, that's why it's so important what, you know, you're trying to do with this festival is to rethink, reimagine, you know, and how theater has been presented up until now, right? Like, and I think it's as simple as that. I did a performance yesterday and, you know, live, it's been a while, so nice to have an audience. And, you know, ultimately we're artists because we want to bring people together, regardless of gender, race, et cetera. We want to acknowledge our diversity, but I do think that, the power of a festival is that you can present such a plethora of content, right? You know, it could be a classical Greek play with, you know, very diverse artists, you know, but it could also be a like African play that nobody has ever heard of with a diverse cast. You know, how interesting would that be too, right? You know, but I'm pretty sure, was it the speaker before me who mentioned, there was two aspects that I retained, which is, you know, the need to, you know, I think artists don't necessarily need to educate. I feel like our art does it automatically. When we present a piece of art, whether people know or don't know, it's so interesting when I finish performing, people are like, wow, I didn't quite get this, but I felt this. And I feel that that's what it is. It's all about feelings and emotions and what it, if maybe the focus is on pushing the envelope for folks who may have never experienced something to, you know, like even ignite a spark of change, you know, then it's okay. You know, we can't expect someone to come to the theater and be like, oh my God, I'm getting out of this and I'm fully, you know, woke, transformed, or aware of everything. However, I feel that, the way, these classical plays could be presented would be a change. And I think, encouraging women to work, you know, to basically be more present in this industry. I think this, for example, is the first step, getting together, talking, absolutely. Let's face it, intrinsically, the whole theater world is patriarchal, period. The way arts have been run, Eurocentric and patriarchal. So it's so funny how as women, when we say, well, you know, oh, I have a kid and, you know, rehearsal schedule doesn't really work for me, we're almost like apologetic about it. And I think it's really about taking a stand and saying, this doesn't work for me, you know, and how can you accommodate something as simple as rehearsals so that I can be part of it because, you know, putting children in this world is also important. And I think just the simple act of listening more to female voices is also, a way to bring change. And I think this platform, for example, is just it. But I don't want to repeat what everybody else has said. But I did want to mention that, yeah, from my perspective, as someone who wasn't even, you know, I encountered, you know, the whole world of theater only when I started Randolph. And all of a sudden I was like, oh, there are all these plays and these musical theaters, you know, musical theater plays that I've never heard of. And, but it was almost like, well, this is what we do. This is what you should do if you want to become an actor. While I know of other, many, many, many other plays that were written by African folks, but, you know, they've never been put on the stage here.
I just wanted to quickly say, because Lua's hit on my second point that I had written down. So I just wanted to jump in because at school right now, we're talking a lot about the canon and how problematic it is. And this festival that you're looking at is already looking at busting that open. And I think it can be busted open even more. So I just kind of wanted to second what Lua was saying and maybe question what is classical.
Yeah, definitely on that, because from me being an immigrant settler, I obviously want to learn about everything I learned about in theater school. That's almost like the main reason I came to another continent. But at the same time, so I would definitely want to know all about, you know, the traditionally mentioned classical play written by, you know, an English female playwright from the 10th century, for sure. But whether or not the question there is, do I necessarily want to learn it from, you know, the traditional theater education current system when I know it's gonna be 90% from a cisgender white male instructor and, you know, run under certain, just certain way. So for like this again is another great example. Like this would be the group of women I would love to learn from and with and discuss about when we all maybe read a 10th century classical play from a female playwright from England. But at the same time, again, when I heard the word classical, think what's classical in my brain is completely different set of thing, because that's like from where I grew up. And I, again, would love to share those things with, like, for example, this group of women, female identifying artists. And again, for example, from where I come from, there are a lot of amazing, beautiful, old, ancient, Asian dramas, but, you know, from that culture, there's a lot of problematic things involving sexism, or, you know, there's definitely, you know, transphobia, there's definitely questionable gender issues. And, you know, I want to learn about those things, and I would more than love to, you know, be able to share them with, for example, Jillian, and then, you know, we can have a conversation. And yeah, so I think it's about experimenting how we can look at learning and sharing, and how we define classical, what it means, also using this platform.
Thank you. Just to keep us on track, I'm just going to leave the last 2 minutes to Sarah and Hortense, and then we're going to mosey over to question number two. Sarah?
Yeah, sorry. This is amazing. I'm just like, yes to everything. Some of it's been covered already, but I was going to say, like, we need to redefine what classical means, or we're not doing a service to anything really at all. I am really of the school, and not everybody agrees, that if you're going to remake something, reimagine something, you need a reason. There needs to be a real reason. You need to read it and understand why there is a reason you're doing this thing. And that's like, you can't just do it because it's considered a classic. And y'all, the Indigenous folks have been doing theater since the beginning of time. All right. A lot of it has been lost. But I've been recently doing a lot of decolonial research because I'm researching theater specifically in the lives of people with disabilities and intellectual disabilities. And I'm starting from a decolonial like perspective. And there is classical theater that exists long before this classical theater, this westernized theater, this idea that you're up there high on a stage and I sit here and I have to be quiet and I have to act in a certain way and I have to do like all of that. So like that, I think it starts from there. Like, I think we have to start like decolonizing the way we're looking at things because yeah, the oppression of women and the patriarchy comes from colonization. Like it comes from this. So like, so in order to reimagine a space that's safe and inclusive and like that deconstructs this gender binary that really exists anyway. And like, you know what I mean? Like we need to start from there. And that's the festival that excites me. The one that's like, oh, we're putting on this classical play that is this story from Indigenous folks that is like written like so much further before Shakespeare. Like, you know what I mean? Like, and you know, so it needs to, and all of you have pretty much covered that already. We need to like not understand theater as westernized and as a certain way. Like there are different ways that theater presented itself in a lot of Indigenous culture. They don't even have a word for art because art is a part of their life and a part of their experience and a part of their storytelling. So like for me, that's the exciting part of theater, is just like shifting through all the westernized BS and like finding where theater actually began. Like that's classical theater to me. Anyway, that's my little bit.
Well, I've been fascinated by everybody's responses in this, to this question, so much so that I've almost forgotten what was the original question. So I'm going to take it back to, you know, how can we best engage and support female identifying artists? And I would like to start by being the devil's advocate in interrogating the notion of traditional theater, as you know, other people have said. And I'm saying this from the lens of an anthropologist. I did not have formal theater training. I am a playwright, but I'm not an actor. I'm not, I'm not trained in that argot. But from the cultural anthropological perspective, I do find it fascinating that the default of the term classical is Eurocentric. Coupled with that is the notion of the paradox of two theater worlds, one in which, there are resourced productions, large regional theaters that are mostly populated by men, and another world that is made up primarily of theater festivals and workshops with very strong representation by theater women. And it's not an open system, where the festivals lead to actual productions because theater decision makers are not watching the work being done at these festivals. The Count, which was a publication produced by the Dramatists Guild in 2014, I believe, mentioned that women are flourishing in low pay, no pay, or self-produced theater worlds. And if we are embarking on yet another festival of women's works, I might suggest that we really look to see how these institutionalized structures that have been self-reinforcing and self-perpetuating, keeping the male patriarchy in place, can begin to be questioned. One of the ways that we're doing that is, for instance, with these webinars where women are talking with one another, and the roles of the bottleneck positions like literary managers and theater critics are now increasingly being populated by women. But the numbers are still very skewed against our favor. And so I would suggest that in embarking on creating a festival, that we set things in place like having theater reviewers and perhaps getting the attentions of literary managers, people who are deciding what makes that leap from the free theater festival world into the more established venues so that it can become part of the canon that people accept as classical works. That was, in short, what I have for question one.
Excellent, brainstormers. We are off to a great start. And we are moving swiftly on to question number two. Brainstormers, how can we deliver the issues facing women in theater with positive, uplifting messaging?
I'm just going to be the first to talk every time there's a question, apparently. So I'm just going to jump in. So, like, that's the hard question for me, right? Because I'm like, I think we haven't been angry enough yet. You know, like, that's kind of my take on it, on some level, right? And I, you know, I don't mean that as in necessarily, well, I don't know, maybe I mean it as in burn down the buildings, but I, you know, don't quote me on that. So it's a difficult question to tackle, but I do, you know, I love what Hortense just said, and I agree, you know, that we need to implement these female voices. But, you know, one idea that I'll piggyback from that into this is one way to make it positive, or that could be inclusive and positive, is asking female artists from the industry, female identified artists from the industry, to write their own reviews and post them on social media, so that we're not relying on systems that don't include us anyways, you know, and that it's about women supporting women. You know, there's that famous classical quote unquote play called Women Beware Women. Well, you know, here we go. Women support women. And maybe there's something about using that, using the voices that are already in place and interested in engaging in these conversations and see the necessity of them, and using it to uplift each other's work and bring it forward.
I wanted to add to what Hortense said also, and I was thinking that, so everybody here are theater practitioners. So what if, as a, you know, as a group or of the group, that we presented the issue in a series of short skits, like you want it to be positive messaging. So a series of short skits, like Baroness von Sketch type things. And you send out invitations to this production of what is the problem to male and female ADs, and it could be virtual or as a production. And so the first half is the skits. This is the problem. This is the problem. This is the problem. This is the problem. These are the issues, not problems. These are the issues that we face in terms of gender and parity. And then the second half, talkback session where we not just discuss the issues but try and create tangible action steps that can be implemented to, you know, try and address.
Go ahead.
Well, I just created a shot list of things that were based from a series of discussions I've had with people, for instance, from the Dramatists Guild, the International Center for Women Playwrights, and let's see, Theater Women, Women Stages of the World. And this is over the last several years. And you know, there has been some great change, but the list is still very relevant. And so number one, we're doing it, building awareness, educating and creating consequences, and reaching decision makers, theater subscribers, and the theater going public. One of the big questions that was posed was, what is the financial incentive to change for this, you know, the present system to change and allow greater access for women? And some of the suggestions had been, for instance, to create gender parity toolkits or to track production data and to identify theaters that are getting tax breaks but are not addressing gender parity guidelines. We can be forming alliances like what we're doing right now by being part of this wonderful Formidable Friday discussion. We can be creating resources for up and coming and also established theater artists. And give to incentivize people doing the right thing and not knowing how to, by providing access to things like this, workshops and discussion groups. Finally, a lot of people said, you know, we could get productions at festivals, but how do we get onto those main stages? And there there was a question that still is unanswered after these several years, which is how can we provide direct access to the producers or the decision makers for, you know, each season's presentations? What is the way to get the works that is being produced at these types of festivals into the hands of people who will actually put them on the stage? I don't know the answer to that, but hopefully we can all start putting our heads together to start answering that question.
I think in part that's challenging the arts councils. And also, instead of just challenging the artistic directors or the artistic representatives in these organizations, but challenging their board of directors as well, who are meant to govern, who are meant to ensure certain policy, who are meant to ensure, you know, I can't remember the specifics of this, but I remember some company coming forward a little while back, a few years ago, and they were like, okay, well, within 3 years, we'll have gender parity. And it was like, why is it going to take 3 years? Like, isn't that, can't you just hire different people next year? Do you know, like, why? And they never actually achieved it. I kept my eye at, you know, in the Canadian market. And I don't know a company that necessarily yet has season to season this kind of equity going on. But yes, I think we challenge the board of directors and we challenge the people who give the money to these organizations to do better.
Yeah, I think I was going to piggyback for sure. Like, I think calling out inequity on all levels is the first thing. And, you know, encouraging one another to speak out is, I think, the first thing. I am always a very self-reflective person. And I'm always, I think one of the things that was asked also, how do we become part of the solution, which is always, you know, it's always great when I feel that I can, you know, what is my part into it? How can I contribute? I think it's so empowering. And for me, you know, it's all, you know, one of the things, it's like, okay, first and foremost, hiring more female personnel, you know, hiring more women and putting them in positions of leadership, period, right? I am the artistic director of a company. And so, you know, how is my company structured? I think that's the first thing. And like Rosanna was saying, you know, who is on, you know, who is on my, sitting on my board? I think that on there's the personal aspect, you know, how can we be part of directly part of that solution? It's immediate, you know, how many, and looking at, hey, how many diverse people, you know, gender-wise, culturally speaking, we have perhaps as part of our cast of, you know, that's definitely, you know, I think one of the solutions. And I definitely think there is stakeholders for sure. I mean, it's going to take more time to change, to change that. It's so deeply rooted, right? Why, when I think of, you know, presenters, theaters, publishers, and producers who are obviously mostly, you know, the usually the higher ups are men. I think it's, knowledge is power, right? So sometimes it's important to do the research and understand who is leading that organization, and, you knowing who is at, you know, at the higher levels, and then having honest conversations with them. I do that, especially when we're collaborating with another organization, especially if they're bigger or they've been there for a long time, and really, you know, seeing if they're open. I think you always also want to do it in a compassionate way, right? You know, and point it out in a, you know, loving and compassionate way. But I think that, yeah, being part of the solution to me also means being an active agent of change. So placing yourself in key places where you can really make sure that your voice is heard. Doesn't mean you're always going to be successful at, you know, being heard, but it does take courage too. So for sure, that sisterhood, I think, is part of the agent of change. And the male counterparts that are surrounding us, simple as your partner or for example, you know, dancers that I'm working with or other actors that I'm working with, making sure that you're constantly having those conversations so that are they aware of what's going on? Yeah, I think that that's key.
Yeah, it's challenging too though, because like I've also had those conversations with many, many people. And because there's this idea of like the auteur, artistic director at the top of the heap, do you know? And this position, this role is often attributed to, is usually attributed to men. Whereas like a female in that same position is, you know, the terrible fear is she's going to do a bunch of collective creations and devise theater about menstruation somehow. And then the whole theater, you know, structure will fall to pieces. And what will we do? And that's actually something that was said to me when I was first starting my career. I was, you know, in my late teens, and a female well-known established director turned to me and said I had two choices. I could either become a successful director, in which case I had to shave my hair off and dress like a man and do male work, or I could make no money and grow my hair long and make plays with my girlfriends in the forest about our periods. That's literally a direct quote. That was her career advice to me at that age. And in some ways, you know, the horror is finding out that on some level that's still true. Do you know, it's like 25 years later and I'm like, what? Damn it, that's what she meant, do you know? And so, and I've had these conversations, you know, with certain various artistic directors, but I've also had this conversation with students and really introducing them to the fact that they actually will help determine the future, just as we will help to determine that future. And to revisit this idea of we need this male auteur in this role in order for the theater to be financially and artistically viable. You know, that it will work as a business because men are practically minded and it will work, you know, and that idea also can afford to be challenged. But it's difficult because in a way in Canada, there are only so many places you can go to get a job. And so we have these people holding on to these roles for like 18 years. And then we get season after season after season of the same thing. And nobody wants to fire that person after they've been doing it for a handful of years because, of course, you know, they have some kind of track record. So I think maybe it's also about, you know, sharing information on how to reconsider the actual structure of these companies, other ways of looking at the way a company can operate that could be just as financially viable, but also artistically inclusive, receptive, and reflective of the industry, the people in the industry, and the people in our broader communities.
I just wanted to say, Rosanna, that I would pay money to come to the forest and watch your play about periods. So just putting that out there, if you ever change your mind and actually are going to do that, I'm there.
Don't think I haven't, but done that. I'll do it again, but there you go.
Cast me in it. I did actually, I heard the question a bit differently of how can we deliver the issues facing women in theater with a positive and uplifting message when it comes to Me Too or the patriarchy pretty much at large. I heard that is more of like the narratives in which we tell, and sorry if this is taking it off track, but it just made me think often we want to create art that has said something about like, this is what Me Too is, and this is what happens to me, or this is what the patriarchy is, and this is what happens to me. But none of that is new information for women. We all know that we are repressed in these ways. So I've changed my mind a little bit in that I am starting to think that showing women what they don't know about themselves, like we don't know how strong we can be. We don't know what great leaders we can be. We don't know what incredible decisions we can make, or how passionate we can be, or how effectively angry we can be so those narratives when it comes to like, this is what the patriarchy is, or this is what Me Too is, I find those are often more towards a male audience of like, please hear us, please understand us, and please make this better. And they just don't get it. So making things for women so they can see themselves as who they could be is what I would love to see.
Yeah, I'd like to piggyback on that. Oops, sorry.
Go ahead.
That's actually also my first instinct when I read the question. And I find to second both Lua and Jillian is that for myself, I find a very significant shift in my voice is when you just think about the group, like who are you talking to? And a lot of time, for example, in the, you know, like the Asian theater or immigrant theater, a lot of the pieces is literally trying to explain our experience to people who don't understand. But most of the time, that's not the group that will try to understand anyway. And I find, and the moment I shift my personal energy and who I work with, who I engage with, more so to the community I want to support, I want to help, instead of the community I'm trying to fix, all of a sudden, naturally, there's a shift in my tone, in my creative work, because there's way less of a victim descriptive kind of narrative. Is like right now, for example, I've been, because I think part of the anger just come from, you know, not being heard, not being understood. And so the moment I started to work with, for the longest time, I was frustrated that even though we have a similarly diverse actor, artist, representative in the theater world physically, that doesn't necessarily translate to culturally, because in my community, for example, immigrant artists are almost at 0% in theater, because, you know, the opportunity has been given historically to physically diverse people born and raised here, having the same, you know, this education here, and people who doesn't speak perfect English gets zero chance, even though they look the same. And I have been frustrated, but then at one point I just started directly working with the immigrant community who might be outside of the existing theater world. And all of a sudden I have so much energy, and, you know, my voice becomes more positive because I'm not worried about being understood. I'm part of the change, just like what Lua mentioned. I lost track of my thought, but that's what I'm piggybacking on. Thank you.
Yeah, I was really glad to hear kind of that point about, like, often it's really tempting, I think, to want to only portray stories about women in or female identifying people, like, in pain, and that we kind of glorify in that. We're like, oh yeah, like, I want to see these women, like, you know, The Handmaid's Tale or like other things like that, where we kind of, there's this tendency, I think, to like revel in that in a way. And while that's important, and I totally agree about, like, we need to show what, you know, I think it was said, like, what has happened to us, I think it's also important to show, like, yeah, like, what we're capable of and what our strengths are. And I think classically, like, if we're thinking about, like, reclaiming, like ancient kind of scripts and stories and things like that, I think that part of that like goal towards presenting things in a positive and uplifting way, I think it kind of comes from, like, a need to show women like finding their own voice and finding their own way, when whether that is through, like, I think we said earlier about, like, editing or directorially, or like through gender conscious casting, like, how can we center women in stories that aren't always about them in pain and aren't always about them experiencing tragedy, right? So I think that I've done that kind of work sometimes with some colleagues, where if you, like, taking a show like the Bakai, for example, where, like, it's all about women in pain and you want to transform that, how can we, like, maybe the story is different, maybe the decisions that we get to see are different. So I was just really glad to hear that, because it's tempting to be like, I want to see women being tragic, because we deserve to have that shown, we deserve to have that side voiced. But I think there deserves to be a balance as well of, can we celebrate the joys of being a woman as well.
Yeah, I love all of that. You know, the tricky thing for me with that is that, how do we get that recognized by the moneyed bodies as not just being like the lady show?
Actually, can I jump on that as well?
Sure. I had a thought where I think sometimes there's also a tendency kind of marketing wise to be like, this is a show for women and women only to enjoy, and men, you shouldn't even consider it. Or like if there's a piece that's for women, like men really can't enjoy it. And I don't know if that always needs to be true. Like, I think, yes, sometimes we deserve to have our own space and to hold our own environments and our own audience spaces as well. But I think, you know, man is the default of humanity. That's garbage. Like, women are human as much as men are human, right? Like, I think we're equal in terms of how our experiences are universal in some ways, right? Like, so I think sometimes that the money is like, oh, well, that's a show for the ladies. And I'm like, that's not always, like, maybe is there a way that we can present this as an opportunity for all audiences to enjoy stories? And yes, they happen to be by women and about women, right? But they're for everybody, possibly.
And in terms of money and resources and like partnership, I think a possibility is like we need to accept that we might need to look outside of our existing theater structure, because the existing theater structure is like historically has been excluding and only keeping certain people. So for example, when we work with, you know, immigration community and realize, well within the current system, there are not a lot of major company or funding sources that's like interested in this. We have to go to other community outsource, is for example, you know, the restaurant community that's like full of immigrants, and sometimes that's a great funding options, or like be working with female historians, is that a word? But like, for example, meeting Hortense today, even though at one point you said you don't consider yourself coming from like necessarily a theater background, but so much of the information you provide today is so powerful that, you know, that hasn't happened a lot, that I haven't heard of from, you know, former conversations only within the tight theater communication. So I think part of it might be outreaching to outside non-theater community who can support this cause. In a way.
I want to piggyback on the outreach. That word has been my like buzzword of the last couple of months. Though I don't know a lot about outreach, I'm not super well versed in that. I believe that can be a key component in getting more people to come, and in relation to outreach, creating affordable prices for audience members, taking care of your audience, creating an opportunity to have the audience be a part of the conversation, whether that be a talk back or, you know, upon leaving the show, there's, you know, you get a paper with more resources you can check out on the material being explored or what have you. And then I just want to like also quickly say, in regards to this idea of reimagining like myself as a female identifying person, what I could be. This is me coming from, like, I'm 2 years out of school. I'm very emerging as an actor and creator. And sometimes I get boggled down by that question, because I think I'm still figuring out who am I underneath my body. And besides my womanhood, which is a big part of my journey, who am I? And really like detailing that as a means to then moving forward and like who I could be. So making that as much a part of the mental and physical process of figuring out of representation and moving towards who I could be with that, I think is something like I would really appreciate in processes.
I think not piggybacking on a whole bunch of things. I know that obviously the barrier and of the patriarchy and of men being in charge of all these systems is there, but I think that we also have another opportunity and an avenue to look at how expansive and kind of bouncing off of what Rebecca is saying, how expansive womanhood is and also Paige. And if this festival or anything that you do includes people with disabilities, includes captioning, includes immigrants, as Phoebe is saying, includes obviously people of color and Black stories and all these stories. This is the idea, you know, when you picture, or at least me, and maybe it's my, when I pictured when Rosanna was saying, oh, you know, the play where all the women go into the forest and talk about their periods, in my head, they were all white. They were all white, and they just like, everyone like, and they all went and danced in the woods. And like, and it's like, you know what I mean? So we can also, we can make a festival that is about lady, white feminism stories, which has been done about 40 million times over, or you can do a festival that is queer and that is indigenous and that includes all these folks. And I really do feel that that is universal, that all of a sudden all the men in those communities aren't going to go, oh, putt, this is not for me, and walk away. I don't believe that. Like, I think that there is, if it is an expansive safe space that is really that inclusive and that radically accessible, like, that opens the doors.
Yeah, I just wanted to add one thing. I think also what Sarah and Phoebe were saying, that when I just reread very quickly the question in terms of issues facing women, just maybe just a quick reminder that a lot of issues that women are facing are not spoken about because we put on stage a very bland, quite frankly, like only a certain set of folks are given, you know, the space to speak. And, you know, when Phoebe mentioned, you know, immigrants, as you know, I went to school and I barely, you know, I still have an accent. And I think that, yeah, the it goes so much deeper, like the, just how folks are cast, who is being cast, and whose stories we're telling. I think there just a lot of attention needs to be placed around that as well. And that I think it goes back to, you know, the issues faced by women are very diverse as these women are. And I think that that's just really just to, you know, conclude all of that.
Thank you. Brainstormers, excellent insights. Keeping this moving on to our final question. How can we tackle the stats on women in theater and best track this?
There are various bodies tracking stats, Stats Canada included. The councils track stats, et cetera. And then there's another one that I'm just blanking on right now that are tracking these stats. But, you know, everybody's kind of doing it through their lens, right? And I think there's an old report, the Rita Fraticelli report, that specifically looked at female stats across the country. I can't remember when it was originally done, but I know there was a revision done of it. Maybe it was done in the 80s or something initially, or 70s, and then it was revised. And what I appreciated to some measure about that is that it was an independent collection of stats that was really, really looked across the entire country and looked at more than just one aspect. It wasn't just about women. And so maybe we need an independent board that specifically, you know, an independent organization that's specifically responsible for collecting this information.
My instinct when I read this question, like Rebecca, I'm kind of newly out of school and out of theater school in my training, and I'm emerging. So I don't know a ton about the stats and like how to find that and everything. But I just wanted to add, because like that's directly where I'm coming from, is that I think any gathering of stats and information that's being done on the industry, I think it, everything in the industry at a micro level is reflected deeply in our training programs, is at least in my experience. Like, it's very evident in theater school that there is such a clear disparity between how the male identifying students and how the female identifying students are treated in terms of like opportunities available, in terms of like expectations of conduct, in terms of like the environment of the room. It's very clear that the male identifying students are more valuable to the program, and that the program and the staff know that those students will have an easier time in the industry. So, which is obviously pretty disheartening when you see like your female cohorts working like three times as hard to not get those same opportunities. So I'm just trying to say that I think the stats that we're gathering, I think it deserves to also include the training level because I do think it is a big reflection of the industry. And I think like it starts at that level. And so I don't think that like if you jump out of that into a new environment, you bring all that with you. So I think it has to start there.
Yeah, I fully agree. And also I think so much staff collected from that gap from a student graduated from such institution until they in some way establish in the professional theater world, something in between there, so much is happening and it's not being addressed. And there is some sort of survey being asked from educational institutions. At one point as a front desk staff have to, you know, call people and, you know, ask them questions like how many, you know, full-time paid professional job you have within 2 years of graduating. And just from that question and how it's being asked and how professional work it's defined in this question tells you how much like the question, like the person who's asking this question doesn't necessarily understand how this industry works. And also oftentimes is that again, that also reflects on, because I was thinking like, well, possible places to collect data are from institutions, for example, these schools or theater companies. But also again, if we use these educational institutions as examples, most of the time people at the top, at the admin or leadership level actually don't, like they don't know these stats. It's the students or maybe some instructors, the graduates who knows what the actual statistics are like. So again, that is not a solution. That is like another observation that I don't know whether, but I feel like the more accurate version of stats comes from probably more of a lower up grassroots kind of collection strategy that could probably reflect more truthfully. Yeah,
I mean, I agree with you 100%, Phoebe, for sure. Because I do think that there is an invisible majority of artists who are not necessarily considered in this information, that are independent artists that are in this industry who aren't necessarily represented by an agent or aren't necessarily represented by a union or aren't and are, you know, maybe doing a show a year or two shows a year, and they're trying to work their way through. And often their information isn't considered in that gathering of information. So the idea of starting in schools, I agree, but also checking in with that emerging community and working from there, working upward from there is absolutely a great idea.
I also wanted to add that because, you know, I cross over the dance world as well. One of the main issues, and I think if anything, this pandemic has really shown this, there's no working together, right? Like I received so many surveys, I had to like make a choice as to which survey I was gonna fill. And that's a little bit puzzling to me, you know? And sometimes with Alex or other folks that I know very well in the arts world, we wonder why folks are not working together, right? Why is Canadian Heritage not working with the Arts Council? And, you know, like, I think one database is all we need. I think like stats, the problem with stats is when you have, you know, very many, many different people who are taking stats here and there, and they're not connected. So that's first for me, the first problem that needs to be identified. Why am I receiving five surveys from five different organizations when they could all work together? And I think that part of it is because stats, some, you know, they can also be very, like they lack that humanity, right? You know, and I think maybe festivals are really working, you know, with the new festival that, you know, my company is envisaging, it's also, you know, an oral tradition you sit down, you speak about an issue, and then everybody listens. And of course, we live in a bigger world. We can't do, you know, not everybody can be sitting at, you know, have a seat at the table and sit. But I think that recording these voices, taking that and then understanding how to improve is another way, you know, of recording stats, because stats don't have to always be, you know, this like question with, you know, A, B, C, D. I got very frustrated filling out, I think, was it the Toronto Arts Council survey or the True Canada Arts Council survey, saying, well, why do I have to choose? Can it not be a holistic approach and include all of these points, right? So I think that the method of recording is also Eurocentric, right? Very like, you know, 1, 2, 3, pick between this, da-da-da, and can we just not think outside of the box, right? And so, unfortunately, I have to say, like, I think for me, like, right from the roots, there's a lot that needs to change in just the idea of how we record things, you know? And, you know, I totally think that we live in a world where, you know, writing is essential. We need to, you know, have that. But there can be other methods of recording stats. So, yeah. And I think it's important that there should just be one place where we should all go to and, you know, just be able to access it instead of like these million different places.
Well, maybe there's something interesting about like in a theater festival situation is if there was actually a place like a camera or whatever where you could do like 2-minute story or something, do you know? And that we record, you know, obviously a slice of someone's life, of their presence as an artist. You know, there might be something interesting about doing something like that as a different means of collection. I really appreciate that notion. So the question is for me is how do you achieve that at a broad scale, but maybe as a step in that direction is developing an initiative where you actually capture that information in real time.
Just to piggyback on that, when I was in theater school, I was like cast as like this strong female role of Miss Elma in Summer and Smoke. I don't know if you know it. But the scene that I was doing, the guy who I was in the scene with, he kind of had all the lines, and just like my job was to support him. So just on a small idea for this festival, it would be really neat to see the statistical number of words spoken by women as opposed to spoken by the male characters, if there are there. I just think that would be interesting. But stats scare me because it's math, so I'm done now.
I'd like to call attention to the count that was underwritten by the Dramatists Guild and was taken over a 3-year period, interviewing and collecting data from theaters across the United States and interviewing literary managers and playwrights. I've placed the link in the chat box, and I encourage all of you to look at it, particularly version 2 of the count that was written up by Julia Jordan. And she's the executive director of the Lilies, which if you're not aware of, is an annual collation of plays by women that have been nominated by theaters, produced plays and unproduced plays as well. And the Lilies and the Kilroys are attempts by the Dramatists Guild and its members and various playwrights and theater organizations to highlight the work of women. And I think this has been very instrumental in starting to get the theaters to pay attention to new works written by women. And it has opened up a whole new cottage industry as well for women to take up as dramaturgs and as theater critics in this new wave of awareness that people are starting to recognize, not just for women. We are in a time of racialized identity politics as well. And so I think this, in terms of, you know, what we can be telling women artists, something positive, I think people in general are paying more attention. I think audiences are more willing to hear stories of and by women that are not of, you know, the traditional structure that had been dominated by male writers, male literary managers and directors. So I think we are at an exciting time. And ironically, you know, in the lead up to this talk, Alex jokingly said, like, the skills that she's learned during this pandemic impress even her. And I think this can apply for many of us as we learn this new field of theater that we're all navigating, that is now going to be playing itself out through these little boxes on Zoom and video and YouTube. And in a way, it is leveling the field in a way that's very exciting, I think, because now people have access to the tools for creating theater and performance that is accessible by wide, much wider audiences than in traditional theater venues. So I think that the future is bright, and that with our collective energies and supporting one another, teaching the new generation of younger women artists how to brand themselves, and, you know, not brand themselves, but to promote their work and to bring out what have been traditionally seen as, you know, weaker feminine qualities as actual strengths and superpowers. And so I, as an optimist, tend to think that we are in a time of great hope for women and underrepresented voices in the performing arts world. Thanks for creating such a venue for all of us, Alex.
And thank you all for participating in this first ever Formidable Friday, not the last. We hope to do these on a somewhat irregular basis leading up to the festival, so we can hear more voices and have more perspectives that we can apply in our preparations to make sure that we're, you know, covering as many bases as we can. So I thank you all so very much for joining me this evening and sharing your energy and sharing space. And until we talk again, I think that there is strength and empowerment in numbers. And I hope that one thing we can maybe take away is that we need to start talking to each other more and collaborating more so that we can achieve more. Thank you, everybody. Good night. Until next time.